I move for a vote of no confidence in Chancellor Valorum's leadership.
There he is, man. Check it. Order! Hey, what up? Let's get on with it. Welcome to my channel, Sequential Geek. I be that Sequential Geek, and this be my haul, yo. Last week, I went to a couple of comic book shops. Colorado Coins, Cards, and Comics. It's north of Denver. I took 470 West, which turns north, and it goes through all these like massive outcroppings of earth and people that tailgate you. So you're checking out all this amazing nature while everybody here loves to fuck with each other. It's fucking great. And took 70 East, then Wadsworth Boulevard North, Colorado Coins, Cards, and Comics. They're going to be going out of business, and it's really friendly people that run that shop. It's kind of like strip mall environment by Dollar Tree. So I went there, 50% off sale, got a bunch of comics, and then went to Mile High Comics last week that had 60% off, 60. And you should look up all their inventory on their website. That's what they use when they look up inventory, back issues. So if you go to their website, that's what they're telling me. They're like, you know, you're giving me like 8-10 books to look up. Just, you know, if you want, they're like, go to our website. I thought they had a workstation there for customers to look up comics, and they said they never did over at Mile High, but shit, I used it. So, Colorado Coins, Cards, and Comics, 50% off sale, right? Just let me see if I can go through this haul real fast. And then I went to a couple of other shops today. It's the 11th of December. So in 1994, this Dark Horse reprint of Marvel's run of Star Wars comics. This is the first reprint since they came out, printed by Marvel in 1980. That second one on the right, these are both out of 1994, classic Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back. Issue 1 on the left, that comprises of Marvel's Star Wars, issue 39, 40, and 41. By Archie Goodwin and Al Williamson, both of those issues. So Boba Fett's first reprint, his first appearance, that's issues 42, 43, and 44, that Marvel Star Wars run. It's right here reprinted. So it's really hard to find this one out in the wild. I can find this one out in the wild pretty often. So these are half off, so I got this for $6. I think the other one's $6 as well, so $3 each. I'm not seeing a date on this concept artwork in the back, but just wanted to show off. It's like a collector, for the most part, of Boba Fett. I mean, I got his first appearance and some key back issues, at least for me. Yeah, trying to collect that Dark Horse Boba Fett stuff, especially in newsstand, is not easy. But if you check out some of my past comic book haul vids, you'll see that I fared pretty well in those Dark Horse books. Yeah, I liken this concept sketchwork back here. Some stuff reminded me a little bit of Von Baudet. I mean, that is, what, late 60s? An independent artist. His son, Mark Baudet, did some Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles comics, but like right here. Is that signature? Alright. This book one here is pretty easy to find, I think, out in the wild. This is a decent condition. I'd say high grade. both of them. ...1994, Dark Horse Comics. I believe this is the first reprint of Boba Fett. Boba Fett's first appearance. Also got, for $3, also $6. That's a direct edition copy, but it's a 4-issue limited series. I managed to find two through four... newsstand from a seller on eBay, and then number one a newsstand from a separate seller on eBay, both all for around like $4 a piece. You know, like $3.50, $4.50 shipping though, unfortunately. Yo, I have been finding a lot of books on my bucket list. Just yesterday I found the Crow book I was looking for, the Crow Death and Rebirth from IDW, the James LeBar. He does one cover. He does, I think, a couple covers for issue one, but I digress. I'm finding a bunch of stuff and it's really fun. This I've got multiple copies of, even in direct. If it's in at least VF shape, I'll probably grab it because I find it to be, you know, you got the terms timeless and you got the term iconic, right? I mean, this is like this Harrison Ford, right? The face of Star Wars, really. Unfortunately, he wasn't too into it. He actually requested to be killed off. The last three of the whole operatic set of movies I thought was awful. The way that they had Harrison Ford go out was pretty fucking bad. Total slap in the face to fans, but that's what those last three were for. And this drawing right here, I find to be more hearkening back to my age. Just a little bit more of a classic, kind of a Mad Magazine type of look of Harrison Ford. The look on Chewbacca, even with the highlights, that reminds me of the old original figurine too. So that combination of robot, human, alien, that purple font, just a cool cover. It's a great classic Star Wars image right there. So it's an origin story, different stories of different characters throughout the Star Wars mythos, telling stories about Chewbacca. It's written by Darko McCann, and each issue has a different interior artist. The covers are all done by Sean Phillips. This one is April 2000, and the first issue is January, cover date 2000. 4-issue limited series. No, Mala Tobak. That's Chewbacca's wife. She's in the first issue. Atichituk. Chewbacca's father. And then later issues, like this one, it's going to be like Luke Skywalker, Han Solo, doing recollections of telling stories about Chewbacca. But those people, His wife, and his wife is Mala Tobak. Her first appearance is actually Star Wars issue 91. That's from the original Marvel Star Wars issue 91 from 1985. So this is from 15 years later, out of Dark Horse. Chewbacca origin stories. Kick-ass, brilliant Sean Phillips cover out of the year 2000. And then switch gears a little bit. You know, just finding some Crow stuff. Got this nice The Crow Flesh and Blood issue 1. So this is the first series after the Kitchen Sink Press 1 through 4. Of The Crow. I think it was what? You had The Crow issues 1 through 4 out of Kitchen Sink Press. And then I think the first two of issues of that 4-issue limited series were reprinted in Tundra Press's first issue. That Tundra did a 3-issue run. So it was like issues 1 and 2 were reprinted, and then issues 3 and 4. We're in the second issue. And then the unprinted fifth issue was the third issue of the Tundra reprint of The Crow. And then there was a script, another movie script that James O'Barr had written. And James Vance, the writer, interpreted it for this comic book. And Alex Maleev, who later became famous with his run on Daredevil around the year 2002, I think it was, 2001, that whole new Marvel era. I met Alex Maleev at an Emerald City Comic Con around 2008, I think it was, 2009. He was so cool. I was broke. I didn't have any money at the time. He was like, just come back at the last hour. And I was like, all right. And he did a quick ink wash drawing of Batman. I said, anything you want to draw, man. So like real quick, he did an ink wash and for free. Didn't take him too long. I don't know, 25 minutes. Signed it, initialed it. It's awesome. It's really nice of him. Because when I saw him, I was like, man, you're one of the people that got me back in the comics, you know? Anyway, yes, we are looking right here at a James O'Barr's Crow Flesh and Blood. This was a 3-issue limited series, I believe. Yeah, this ran for 3 issues. May 1996 is this issue right here, is cover date. And then the last one was July monthly. Came out on time. Word. So May 1996, it's the first issue here, this 3-issue monthly run. And that is $4.69, so what, $2.35. CBGB's, Country Bluegrass Blues. And other music for uplifting gormandizers. I got that correctly. Created by Hilly Crystal. If you ever get a chance, check out that movie, CBGB. It's out of 2013. And I can't say it's got the best acting in it for all the guest appearances that they have in there. But it's all done, dare I say, with good taste. Tastefully, if you want to use that word to describe the portrayal of this place Hilly Crystal created. I mean, the birth of punk, you know. It's not just punk, more like, I mean, you've got so many other people in there like Patti Smith, Blondie, Television, E and the Stooges. You know, I mean, I was here in 2001 when I was there in December. No, shit, November 2001. I was in New York City visiting. You know, you have like different worlds, different groups of friends, and a bunch of them happened to be in New York City the fall of 01. And I went out there and couch surfed for 2 weeks. And managed to make it to CBGB's. Made it there once during the day and grabbed a couple t-shirts and then stopped by there at night and waited in line forever to see just some local bands that took forever just to set up and start to play. But I managed to hang out there for about an hour and a half. I mean, man, I was in New York City. I made it in CBGB, but man, I didn't want to hang out in one spot the whole night. It was amazing. I had a fucking blast. I love New York City. Every time I've been in New York City, I love New York City. This place right here should have been considered like a national historical landmark and had been kept open like they do with, I don't know, like in ATL. Margaret Mitchell, I mean, the house that Margaret Mitchell stayed at, the author of Gone with the Wind, they're preserving that in Atlanta. What, they can't preserve CBGBs? The hell? So, This is a 4-issue limited series, and Jaime Hernandez does the cover for issue number 1. I don't know if there are B covers. So this came out in November 2010. Jaime Hernandez cover, Boom Studios publisher. I mean, you got people doing stories like Kelly Sue DeConnick and Kieran Gillen. Chuck BB handled the covers for the remaining issues, 2 through 4. Really digging this Jaime Hernandez cover. So they had 2 issues. $10, so $5 a piece. Now, I don't know if y'all remember, but when Joe Quesada, he was in a band, you know, just, I don't know if it was for fun or whatever, but just playing around town. He's got a huge collection of guitars as well. I don't know if you've seen any interviews with him. I'm not sure which magazine it was, but they showed this huge array of guitars he had hung up on one of his lofts that he had in New York City. And when he became chief creative officer after editor-in-chief, I remember like some of the last Cup of Joe interviews he did back when it was on Newsarama, those vlogs. It wasn't really an interview. It was just his own blog, right? And he was saying how he wanted to have the theme song for both the Marvel Superhero Squad television show and then also that Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes television show. If you check out that website, WCO.TV, that stands for Watch Cartoons Online. If you go to WCO.TV, check out the cartoons link up top, you can see all these cartoons, including like the Marvel What If and so forth. But ultimately, my man Joe Quesada wanted to add some type of punk rock, some type of rock and roll influence to the theme song for both Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes, and listen to the first season, because they have it narrated, some type of narration talking about who the Avengers are on top of the music for the second season. They only did 2 seasons of Avengers Earth Mightiest Heroes. I think same thing with Marvel Superhero Squad. I love this show. I thought it was hilarious. Once again, sort of like that whole concept with New Marvel, even though this came out later, I'm not trying to compare it exactly with the styles of art or indie art that were being pushed with New Marvel. I'm just saying, like, just like with the new era, stuff that we hadn't seen before. We had never seen stuff like there was some really bad cartoon that involved the Avengers, I think, in the late 90s. I mean, shit, there was also a Fantastic Four movie, too, in the early 90s. Nobody wants to talk about that either. So the point is like, there was never really any type of, like, movie, animated television show with Marvel. Continuously, you would see stuff like Super Friends through to the what Dwayne McDuffie influenced, Unlimited Justice League Unlimited, Justice League really kicked ass and set the bar as that would appeal more to a young adult, if not sometimes adult audience. And it's kind of like the humor that was included with Superhero Squad. A lot of the humor wasn't necessarily, you would say, adult-oriented so much as I would just say it would be Marvel fan-oriented. A lot of the references and terms and just subtext, double meaning, the play on words that they have throughout the Superhero Squad show with the jokes that they have that they're laying out, that sure, I could see like some kid would laugh just because it's zany, it's odd, but some of it, like, I don't know, Doctor Strange, they're talking about breaking through these walls just trying to get into Doctor Doom's lair, and then Doctor Strange goes, I broke through the fourth wall, and then he looks at the camera and winks at the audience. Check it out for yourself and have a laugh. Marvel Superhero Squad is my jam. Yo, that was another thing with the Superhero Squad show, is that they wouldn't just include a core set of characters that they would recycle in every episode. they would actually include villains and heroes and anti-heroes that weren't as common in most television shows, or most viewers might not know who the heck they were. And as you can see, like, most people were drawn in this, like, dwarfish, stubby-looking cartoon body type. And just the attitude, the cocky attitude with all the characters playing off each person's background that was established in the comics was just really well done. And the humor is fucking, it's knee slapping. Check it out, WCO.TV. Now this cover right here, now think about it like this, all right? You had the cartoon came out the same time as the comics, all right? So the Superhero Squad show, what did this run for? Okay, as far as I see here at WCO.TV, the Superhero Squad show ran for 2 seasons, 26 episodes in each season. Check it out. They're fucking hilarious. Now, this show came out like 2009, 2010. Right? So to promote the Superhero Squad show, Marvel would have the Superhero Squad show variant covers for just their regular comics. That was in 2009 and throughout 2010. Keep an eye out for those, because there's this comic I got in the mail. After I bought this, I did some research, and different series that came out for Marvel Superhero Squad. You've got a 1 through 12 issue series that came out in 2010, and that's what this one's the first issue for. And then you've got a 2009 limited series that was 4 issues. And the second issue has Reptile on the cover. And now, I think that one, I gotta look up the cover date of that. Yeah, I think that Marvel Superhero Squad 4-issue limited series, the first issue was November 2009. The one with Reptile on the cover, that is December 2009. All right. So now Reptile's first appearance in the Marvel 616 universe, that is in the same month as the one-shot Marvel Superhero Squad Hero Up comic book. All right, so Marvel The Avengers Initiative featuring Reptile. It was a one-shot, and that had a cover date of May 2009, but it hit the stands, physically came out in March 2009, and that is the same month as the Marvel Superhero Squad comic. It was a one-shot called Marvel Superhero Squad Hero Up! Exclamation point. That was out in March 2009. And that Marvel Superhero Squad Hero Up! Comic one-shot, that was a reprint of these web comics that were exclusively seen at MarvelKids.com. And it's that comic that has Reptile. So you've got Reptile coming out the same month in that Marvel Superhero Squad Hero Up, and as well as that Avengers Initiative. This book that you've been looking at this whole time happens to be, I think, the least important one in the Marvel Superhero Squad gamut. I mean, if you want to get a Marvel Superhero Squad comic, I would say, yeah, this would be included in your want list to complete a collection, because this is the first issue of the final run. 12-issue run out in 2010. And the show was from, 2009-2010. The theme song of which I want to play. Hopefully I won't get in trouble. So, the description that they've got over at Wikipedia is, during the first season, the opening sequence of the show, there is a running sight gag similar to the ending of the Simpsons intro. The Hulk will pick up an infinity fractal, and he's transformed by its power into something different every episode. And One of them he turns into Banner. The other one he turns into like the Gray Hulk. Another one, it's like a baby Hulk. Another one, it's just a gag. And so I paid $250. Screaming Mimi was told by a librarian to be quiet at the Superhero Squad show. Oh, yeah. So in 2014, Marvel came out with these reprints. I showed these first two off. I got at another sale at a different shop, and at this shop I was at, it's part of this haul I'm showing off here. I got this one here for book three, the final volume, for 50% off. So basically for $20, it's like $38.99. I don't know much about Miracle Man. I know that when, what was it, didn't Alan Moore do the Eclipse printing? Todd McFarlane ended up buying Eclipse Comics. Is that right? And then Neil Gaiman had written some stories following up Alan Moore, and that led to the whole mythos, the whole dramatic history of comics. Of course, it's gonna involve some type of McFarlane, Gaiman, Moore court case trial deal. So yeah, I don't know much about Miracle Man. Something like when Captain Marvel, like Shazam Captain Marvel, is that right? When that series ended, they had a Marvel Man takeover. And then, because of Marvel Comics, they had to rename it to Miracle Man. There's a lot of information here with Miracle Man, Marvel Man, Neil Gaiman, that I'm gonna have to catch up on here. I am not about to do any type of expose book review on who the hell Miracle Man is anytime in the near future. So I got these three volumes set here now complete to keep me company this winter. I know that when Miracle Man came out in the 80s, that was supposed to be like this new take on superheroes by Alan Moore. contributing to the whole superheroes have to be dark. They don't have to be, but just the whole, you know, marketing departments, once something becomes popular, they have to overplay it, overprint it, overproduce it till you're bleeding out your ears with whatever cliche brand trend is supposed to be pushed down your throat. So that whole dark superhero take, Jesus, this was supposed to be the beginning of it, I guess. This and Frank Miller's Daredevil, Elektra, Dark Knight run, so something to look forward to. Dark and self-loathing. Yay. Hey, just in time for winter. I have no idea. I would say dark and self-loathing. I have no idea. I guess this guy, Miracle Man, he can do whatever he wants. And it's like this God-like concept that is going on. Whenever this person says the word Komoda, it's the word atomic backwards. He turns into a different person. Miracle Man. So his wife ends up having a kid with Miracle Man. There you go. Just for starters. That's all I know. People's having other people's kids. Babies, mamas, in comics. Miracle Man, Marvel Man, Copyright Man. Batman. 3D out of 1990. Now, I showed a copy of this off before. I lucked out. This one was way cheaper. This is 10 bucks, so I got this for $5, believe it or not. It's really pristine condition. Let's see, this is for sure a high-grade copy. It's an original John Byrne story. It involves a penguin. Glasses here. And there's a whole bunch of pinups in here. So in this book, this Rayzone 3D book, pencils and inks are attributed to Kurt Swan and Sheldon Moldoff. That's for the 1953 reprint of The Robot Robbers, Bill Finger's story that actually Charles Paris did the pencils and inks on. And that was originally printed in Batman issue number 42. Rayzone did the 3Dification of this book. And the last book I got out of this 50% off sale is this. It's a standalone story. This is not a reprint. This is a story by Steve Grant with Mike Zeck doing the art. Return to Big Nothing. It's like this Punisher meets the Soji military commander. I don't know, it's an old sergeant or something from when he was in Vietnam. That for about $9. Great condition. Hardcover. Out of Epic Comics. Original price is $16.95, so just basically got it for 50% off cover price. Oh, look at the look in this guy's eyes. Show. And now I've been knocking off a lot of books on my bucket list. I just ordered this comic book in the mail coming in. It's The Crow, Death and Rebirth, issue number 3. And that book I've been looking for. I've got one copy that I found a few years ago. And ever since I've been back spending money on comics, wanted to knock these books off my bucket list, switch gears on the spending, and I got stuff I'm going to be leaving in storage out here in Colorado. I'm moving to back to Michigan, and it's just a bunch of stuff I want to get done and over with so I can leave out in storage. And I've been knocking stuff off this list all of a sudden. It must be because Christmas is coming up. People are posting books, more of their stock online for sale. So I'm buying it up. And I just got The Crow, Death and Rebirth, issue number 3, the James O'Barr cover, my second copy that completes my doubles of James O'Barr books, covers that he's done. Just really psyched to get that another run of books as a collector down. And if you like something, and you think that you're a huge fan of it, then get doubles. If you think that it's something that is a great investment, then get doubles at least. So I want to get doubles of my X-Force run and newsstand, the Milligan Allred run from 116 on, and that run on Grant Morrison's new X-Men, and I got doubles of that in newsstand, and almost got a run a newsstand of Ultimates Volume 1, just need issues 5 and 6, and at least I'll have a newsstand run of that. But getting this comic, these next comics that you're about to see, these next two were huge. Seriously, fucking A, like, let me show you. So Mile High Comics had a 60% off sale. And this is a $100 issue, a fine copy of Ultimates, issue number 12. So I got it for $40, and it is impossible to find these Ultimates comics, volume 1, volume 2, in newsstand. As you can see right there, sometimes, I think typically, especially in later newsstand copies, see how it says 12 at the top of the barcode? You know, it's issue number 12. But I don't know if that's always the case for earlier versions of newsstand. Anyway, so this is issue 12. It's really hard to find in newsstand. They had it over at Mile High Comics. Every time I've been going there, I've been finding something lately. So they must be updating their stock, I don't know, for the holiday, whatnot. So yeah, I just need issues 5 and 6, that the Hulk Rampage of New York. When this originally came out, it's a 13 issue run, the first two volumes, 13 issues each. Mark Millar, the writer, Brian Hitch, he didn't get books coming out on time. They pretty much were coming out every 2 to 3 months, especially towards the end. So this issue came out in November 2003. Issue 13 came out April of 04, the last issue. And I think both of those 13th issues, the final issues in both those volumes, I think those were double-sized. I know definitely in the second volume it was. So anyway, Mark Millar is the writer. Brian Hitch did the cover and the interiors. Groundbreaking work. Kind of just like with those Marvel comic cartoons that Joe Quesada was making sure they had some punk rock and roll music influence in their theme songs. When he was building up to that, those cartoons came out like 2008, 2009, but you know, this Ultimates was like 2001, 2002. Joe Quesada was already moving out of the Marvel Knights imprint to becoming editor-in-chief. Bill Jamas was the president. Dan Buckley was running publishing, if I got that right. And it was Bill Jamas that was pushing the Ultimate run, something to revamp Marvel into the 21st century, something to modernize the Avengers with, modernize the Fantastic Four with, modernize Spider-Man with. A lot of that Spider-Man run that Brian Michael Bendis and, what was it, Mark Bagley? Yeah, Mark Bagley. And when, you know, a lot of stuff that they were doing was influencing the movie that had Tobey Maguire So there was some stuff that people hadn't seen before. Stuff that they were just trying to throw at the wall to see what would stick. They were doing Wolverine's origin with Paul Jenkins. Paul Jenkins brought them the idea with the century, that whole hoax gambit. So there was stuff that was bringing old readers back into comics. There was stuff that was being done that we haven't really seen before, and where we had seen people try, but it just wasn't done well. This was done well. This was done great. If you're new to comics, if you want to recommend somebody, if they're new to superhero comics, tell them to check out Mark Millar and Brian Hitch's Ultimates Volume 1 and Volume 2. So I now got me a newsstand copy. Just got to get issues 5 and 6. When I recently showed in one of my recent vids, issue 2 that I got in newsstand, that's the first likeness of Samuel Jackson as Nick Fury. And that wasn't with his permission. It's real punk rock. It's a real rock and roller move that I really dig that they threw in Samuel Jackson to modernize Nick Fury. It's a real cool choice, and that's what they were going for. Ultimates issue 12. So I got this. This is like a really hard to get bucket list item. And trying to get newsstand copies of those modern comics, especially like the Ultimates, by the way. 5% of the comics were newsstand in the year 2000, and then there were 2% were newsstand by 2005. And the next one that I got that is like, whew, it's just like a VF copy of Fantastic Four 243. I know what this is from 1982. That's the cover date. June 1982 is the cover date. It's a newsstand copy. Usually for me, that borderline between whether you want to get newsstand or direct for me is like 1983. So this is 1982. Still, even if you say, what was it, 15% were direct edition. I mean, people were bagging and boarding their stuff, but they were still buying doubles by 1982, definitely by 1983. So, if it's on a newsstand, it's still getting beat up. But still, those direct edition copies in the early 80s, late 70s, especially those combo packs, they were called like the Whitman packs. Those were only done with Marvel. Those were hanging from a hook on a wall, in a drugstore, at a supermarket, bus stop, airport. So, those direct market books are probably really the ones to get. I guess if I had this in direct market, it's 1982, I'm satisfied. I can't be too picky. Let me just show this off. So this is $113. So I paid 40% of that, right? It was 60% off. Not bad condition, gotta tell you. I would definitely say this is a VF copy. Whether it is VF plus or not, I mean, we're looking at white bubbles, but kind of off-white pages. And so the big deal with this issue is Terax the Destroyer, one of Galactus's heralds. He wants to threaten to crash the island of Manhattan into Galactus's ship if Mr. Fantastic doesn't kill or get rid of Galactus. And I think basically they revive him. They kill Galactus, and it's Mr. Fantastic that brings him back to life. John Byrne doing the story and the artwork, doing the entire story, right? So what is it? They kill him in issue 243, and then He brings him back to life. Mr. Fantastic brings him back to life in issue 244. Is that right? Right. So then it's in issue 244 where Frankie Ray becomes Nova. She wants to sacrifice herself to become Galactus's herald so that he would spare Earth. And Frankie Ray's history, shit, that in itself is actually a lot deeper in the Marvel Universe than you might assume. She's not just some random Air Force agent. A translator, I think she became. She has such a convoluted history, Frankie Ray, who became Nova, because she didn't just get her powers from Galactus. Her, uncle, I believe it is the inventor of the first Marvel superhero. The Human Torch, the android, the Human Torch. It is Dr. Horton. If I get this right, cover date October 1939. Marvel Comics. One of the most valuable comics to hit the market after Action Comics number one, really. We got the first appearance of the Human Torch. We got the first appearance of the Angel. Doesn't really go on to do shit. It's the precursor to, I guess you could say, the X-Men's Angel in that sense. But we have the first appearance of the Submariner. The Submariner, right? We got the first appearance of the Masked Raider. No one cares, right? The first appearance of Kazar, right? Kazar. Zar, that's the name of the lion that he makes friends with. Kazar, right? So we got this guy named John Rand and his wife Constant. They end up dying out in the jungle, and his son David Rand becomes Kazar. I guess you could say that's a precursor to Iron Fist. Danny Rand getting left off in those Tibetan mountains. So that's out of Golden Age, 1939. This is a reprint. This is the 70th anniversary reprint. There's an 80th anniversary reprint of this. So this is $20. What? 60% off. I paid, what, $8? So, I paid a good deal. Got a good deal. And the Submariner is not a mutant, y'all. I mean, come on. And Fen, F-E-N, that's Namor's mom. She went to the surface earlier, 20 years earlier. Fen was sent to the surface to check out the surface dwellers. And she definitely checked out the surface dwellers. She ended up having a kid with this one ship captain out in the, I think, the Arctic. And that's Namor. That's the Submariner. That is not a mutant. I mean, that's a hybrid of two different races that sure could cause someone to become superhuman, because you got this different combination of races. One can breathe underwater, withstand depths of the ocean. The other, if you have this human, maybe there's a mutant gene in that human, but really, Namor is more like just a hybrid. He's not really a mutant. You know, if somebody has a kid with a Kree, that's not a mutant. That's, if that person becomes a superhero, that would just be a hybrid. Something new. An alien child. Superman has a kid with Wonder Woman, that's not a mutant. And then you got the Human Torch. The Human Torch story is by Carl Burgos. He's the writer and the artist. Which is actually the same for The Submariner, is actually written by Bill Everett and drawn by Bill Everett. FYI. But Carl Burgos, I'm not getting this name right, Carl Burgess,
Burgos. That is the writer and artist, the creator of the original Human Torch. And he was this android that was created by this Professor Horton. Professor Horton. Per Comic Vine, having trouble with his latest creation, the first synthetic human, whom he dubs the Human Torch. He keeps the Human Torch in a cylindrical tube that is completely free of oxygen. Once the android is exposed to air, it bursts into flames. I guess that's one of the downfalls of creating an android, you know? It's just one of those hurdles that they just haven't figured out yet. It happens. Androids. As an alternative, Professor Horton, he seals the Human Torch in a concrete tomb until he can figure out how to solve this spontaneous combustion problem. And the Human Torch breaks free. I don't remember how it's, what is he, people are, construction crew accidentally opens it up or something. So this Human Torch doesn't understand why he's bursting into flames. He basically ends up finding this mobster, and he can't remember who he is. And this mobster ends up manipulating the Human Torch. So this mobster uses the Human Torch so that he can carry out insurance fraud. After inadvertently burning down a building, the torch rushes back to this mobster's mansion and burns it to the ground. The torch is doused with liquid nitroglycerin during this clash. Turns out to be the catalyst that the torch needed to be able to control his powers. So now that's the solution. Pour some liquid nitroglycerin on an android. Clears up that spontaneous combustion problem like that. Tell ya. Gets rid of it. Put a little bit underneath the armpits. You're good to go. The Human Torch explains how this mobster took advantage of him. He gets his memory back, and Horton, Professor Horton, reveals to the Torch that he planned on exploiting the Torch for financial gain. So the Human Torch, this android, ends up abandoning Professor Horton, and he wanted to go on to fight crime and injustice. So that's the Human Torch, and this Professor Horton. So when Frankie Ray was 14, her stepfather, Professor Horton, brought her with him to an abandoned warehouse where he kept the chemicals that gave the original Human Torch, the original android, his powers. Oh, so he ended up, I guess, he did decommission the Human Torch somehow. He ended up having the original Human Torch and put in storage. And he was going to pour these chemicals on the torch to as a catalyst to light it on fire again, to wake it up. And she ended up spilling those chemicals, dropping them on the ground, spilling them all over herself. And then she became, Frankie Ray ended up turning into, this was like an issue, Fantastic Four issue, like 238, I believe. So she called herself Nova. She called herself Nova. And then, like, five issues later, in issue 244, on the next issue after this, Frankie Ray, this guy's Professor Horton's niece, she ends up becoming Nova, Herald of Galactus. Her stepfather, Professor Horton, not her uncle, her stepfather. You know, there's all these, like, little connections to the Golden Age that I thought were real interesting. If you check out also Miss America and Bova, if you look at Madeline Joyce, Miss America, right? Her first appearance was Marvel Mystery Comics. Yeah, out of the Golden Age. Miss America, out of the Golden Age, right? Her first appearance was Marvel Mystery Comics number 49. But it was Miss America, Madeline Joyce, right? Her and the Wizard, the Speedster. So her and her husband, they took a tour around the world in the nation of Transia. She sought medical assistance at Wundagore Mountain, sanctuary of the High Evolutionary. One of the artificially evolved persons of the High Evolutionary, Bova, was a midwife and helped Madeline with the birth of her child. Tragically, the child was mutated by the radiation Madeline was exposed to years ago and was stillborn. So the woman, Madeline, ended up, Miss America, ended up dying just hours after the child was stillborn. Bova, this High Evolutionary construct, Bova, the cow woman, right? She tried to ease this husband's pain of losing his wife and the stillborn child. So she presented this man with two other twin children and said they were his. And the wizard was so full of grief that he fled the mountain never to see his children again. These twins that he was told were his, but since he was so depressed, he had to run away and never come back. Apparently that makes sense. And these children were Pietro and Wanda Maximoff. There's a little tidbit for you about some Golden Age connection and some weird way to modern Marvel lore mythology. Like here on the left, Dr. Phineas Horton, creator of the Human Torch, ends up becoming the stepfather of Frankie Ray, who becomes Galactus' Herald in this next issue. First appearance of Nova. Yes, I did. That's right. Y'all know it. So I got those two. And then I do today. Dropped off some comics over at Cobalt Comics. They got this one charity organization they're associated with where they'll collect different types of comics together, compile them together for age groups, and then auction them off for charity. Books that they're going to give away for kids. Want to make sure that they can put a book in every kid's hand type of thing. And I donated a stack of comics for them to use. And after that, I went over to Vision Comics and Oddities. Just got one book. But all right, so real quick, just want to end up showing off these comics I got today over at Cobalt Comics. Like I said, I dropped off a stock of comics for their charity. And then I just went through looking for some John Byrne Fantastic Four. The hour was getting late, and I ended up going to Vision Comics and Oddities after that, but I thought Vision Comics and Oddities was open till 8, so when I got there, they were already closing, and I just got one item from there, which is pretty decent, but start off here with my John Byrne Fantastic Four comics I got today. Just want to go through these real quick. I mean, just to give you a reference, that Fantastic Four comic there on the right. So this really nice high grade newsstand copy came out cover date June 1982. And that's Terax trying to have everybody take on Galactus, right? So leading up to that, I got this today. It's a really nice newsstand copy. This is a real classic Marvel, classic John Byrne. And, you know, John Byrne knew how to bring in those, like, timeless elements that defined the wow, the pizzazz, the eye-catching style, house style of Marvel. That made the Fantastic Four and the birth of the Avengers and Hulk and Daredevil such great commercial icons today. I mean, you got Spider-Man and Iron Man, Thor, Daredevil there at the bottom. Really colorful, nice shape. Issue 242. So we're talking 1982. And John Byrne is in full swing.
This guy right there. This is issue number 238. This is actually 239 is the story of Frankie Ray becoming Nova. And then it's 244 where she becomes Galactus's Herald Nova. She gets imbued with the power of cosmic. Don't you know? So I got that issue 238. It's like a mid to high grade copy. I'd say VF minus. With John Byrne on the cover there. It says it's a 1981 cover date up here. Would be kind of cool if I had gotten this in direct, to be honest, if it was like a Whitman, but given no spine ticks. Yeah. It's pretty great condition. I wish I'd get more feedback from my viewers, from y'all watching, on just your take of a condition. Your feedback here, because if I'm not seeing spine creases, there's a light color break right there. But sharp corners. Some indentation right there. A slight crease right there. Doesn't go all the way though. It just starts there into the middle. How's that? What, white to off-white? Love and kisses to all our fans, Susan Richards. John Byrne, story in pencils. Yeah, and Frankie Ray, she had this, like, Professor Horton had hypnotized her to forget that she had powers. Made her wear this, like, translucent, I don't know, body condom that would inhibit her powers as well. I don't recall, I haven't read it since it came out, but here she is. Mr. Fantastic helps break the hypnotic spell on her so that she can come to grips with her powers and get in touch with her true self. So yeah, here she is. She's with Professor Horton, her stepfather. He's trying to revive the Human Torch, and that chemical that she's carrying, that vat of chemicals, falls on her. And that's what he was going to use to revive the Human Torch. Falls on her, gives her these Human Torch-like powers. And another story where a woman is hypnotized, kind of like what Jean Grey in the movies, as well as Captain Marvel in the movies. And wasn't also Black Widow in the movies hypnotized to forget who she was? So you got Reed Richards bringing Galactus back to life, and then as a consequence, I think what the previous issue, issue 249, was the it's a gladiator. He is the leader of the Imperial Guard of the Shi'ar Empire. I think it's, if you look at the end, one of the last panels of Uncanny X-Men 169, I believe it is. Is that 168? 168. 169 is the first appearance of the Morlocks. Uncanny X-Men 168.
8, I believe it is, there's like a scene where Lilandra is warning the Fantastic Four. She's like leaving this hologram voice message, letting him, Reed Richards, know that she's upset with him for letting Galactus live. From back in this story arc. So she sends the Imperial Guard in issue 249 and culminating in this special 250th issue. $1 cover price. So it's out in 1982. And Reed eventually does get placed on trial in issues 261 and 262. I mean, damn. I paid $6 for this. I can't. What am I supposed to open up every single comic out of every bag, constantly opening them up? I figured I'd trust the shop to a certain extent, but I don't know if you can see the. There's like a stain right there. I mean, the cover looked great, but we got this stain going on right back there. Like some ripples of water damage, some type of food damage, slight staining going on right there. A little disappointed for $6. I mean, yeah, I'd like to take this back. But then there's like the time and gas money for going back to a shop over one comic. I'd like to call him up and ask him what he can do for me first. But yeah, for $6, I don't think that's fair to charge that. What do y'all think? So here is Lilandra, just queen of the Shi'ar Empire. You've got the Kree. You've got the Skrull right there in the background, the shapeshifters. And then you have the Shi'ar Empire. And then their Shi'ar's Imperial Guard is led by Gladiator. And he kind of has like these like psychic, telekinetic, like will powers. He can kind of will it, conceive it. He can have it be done, almost like a cartoon version, like the old school version of Superman, and we could just lift a building up by its corner. You know, obviously all the realism, the demand for realism and fans in the past few decades, you know, everyone would argue that that corner of the building would just break off. But with Gladiator, you know, he can do these kind of like OG cartoon Golden Age Superman type moves. Not necessarily Golden Age, but like a lot, like more like the zany power sets from the code days, the 50s, probably early 60s. The Comic Code Authority that kind of neutered everything and made all the writers and creators go like the zany Space 8 Invaders or Dream Sequence or weird red kryptonite, blue kryptonite route. So, origin of the Fantastic Four being told real quick here. So, Reed is on trial. People in a brace. So I want my money back for this Fantastic Four 261. Alright, so this 250 is not bad shape. It's alright. Was $8. That Fantastic Four 242 I got for $10, by the way. High grade newsstand copy. Four more John Byrne Fantastic Four books. We got the first comic that John Byrne started off with when he was doing full-on inks, illustrating, and writing. Joe Sinnott's 16-year run, beginning with Fantastic Four, issue 44, as the series inker, ends with this issue. This is the beginning of John Byrne's landmark run, timeless run, with some iconic story arc character creations that he did from 232, I believe, to issue 292, which was that like virtual reality world that She-Hulk and the rest of the Fantastic Four were under. It was this like virtual reality World War II world that S.H.I.E.L.D. was using to test the merit character of the Fantastic Four and Nick Fury. They were having them believe that they were in World War II and to see if Nick Fury would go after Hitler or not, whether he would not change time or whether he would go after a maniac like Hitler. Like Hitler's on the cover of that final issue. Sue's long hair is cut short this issue. Eventually he ends up giving her a mullet. Let's see if I got screwed over by the condition of this. Got this for $12. Check something here. Ooh, nice white pages, man. Bright pages. Yeah, the inker right there. It says Bjorn Hain, H-E-Y-N. That is a pseudonym that John Byrne had entered for the inker, although he had done the writing, illustrating, and inking starting in this issue, 232. Taking over from Joe Sinnott's 16-year run as inker, starting with Fantastic Four, issue 44. Until issue 232. I love this issue. I love this cover. There's this, like, coup that occurs in Latveria. And Doom needs the help of the Fantastic Four. I'm stepping over them. Classic Doom image. This land is my land. This land's not your land. From the Danube River through Romania. If you don't like it, well then go fuck you. My ruler is a Dr. Doom. That's how you say it. That is directly translated from the Latverian national anthem. This land is mine. Out of 1982. Loving it. Victor Von Doom. The last two John Byrne comics I got. This comic right here is a shout out to 666. Check out that YouTube channel. He's got a Down the Rabbit Hole video he does, just basically interconnecting these comics, how they are related throughout Marvel's history, not only in comic book publishing, but magazine comic book publishing, and how these comics and characters are linked with the Darkhold. This guy's on his way to becoming a subject matter expert in the Darkhold. And one of the points that 666 ever so generously points out, shares on his channel, this guy does research. So I remember writing a letter to Marvel about this comic. Franklin Richards was being held captive by Mephisto. And he ends up breaking free. Reed Richards enlists the help of Doctor Strange. by the conclusion, by the end of the story, conclusion involves Mephisto being broken up. Franklin Richards had broken up either a piece off or broken Mephisto up into these pieces. And it's these shards that 666 was pointing out that the Scarlet Witch uses to create her kids, Wiccan and Speed. Isn't that his name, Speed? I stopped reading Marvel around the time Young Avengers just came out. I wasn't really against, didn't have a problem with Young Avengers. Actually, I found that to be one of the better titles, but the whole decompressed storytelling and the whole setting things up for the Disney buyout, doing a lot of things that didn't make sense. But they wanted to group characters together more for cross-brand recognition. Anyway, now, so we got Franklin real young being powerful, and then we got the first appearance here on the left, issue 245, of Franklin Richards as this grown adult. And I'm just showing these comics down real quick here. This is one of the most memorable scenes in the entire Fantastic Four history occurs near the end of this story. Franklin is able to look deep inside the Thing's mind. Rather than transform him into human form, like one would think, he does what Ben really wants and makes him his old Rocky self once more. After he does his good deed, Franklin changes back into a little boy. So this comic is out of, like, 1985, I believe. And that's August 1982 for that issue, 245. 245 can be a double cover. That is not a double cover, but it's a classic issue. And I figure if it's got that early 1982, it's like my cutoff date for getting the direct edition. It's a Whitman. I think you can tell it's a Whitman because of this diamond right here, meaning it's a part of that three-pack of comics that once they were sold to a store, you can never return them like you could with the newsstands. And they were put mainly in a very thin plastic sleeve. They couldn't be returned. There was a loop here that they hung on a hook. They were less likely to be damaged. They were easier for people to sift through and throw back on the hook, so they didn't get damaged as much. And they weren't really looked at as collector's item when they were part of Whitman. They weren't in like a rack, a metal rack with like two metal bars underneath that were constantly being damaged or sifted through. The Whitmans were a little bit more well taken care of. People started going to comic book shops really around 1982. So that's when people were bagging and boarding stuff. So that's why I'm kind of hesitant to be psyched about getting something that's direct edition, because I was seeing stuff on the news by 1982. Comic book shops being featured on the news, the price of comic books increasing, them becoming more than just collectibles, but that speculator bubble was starting to be brewing. It really didn't catch hold till really around 84, 85, where everybody was like, pouncing on first issues, new first issues, or anything that was some type of, even if it was like a pseudo landmark, the people in the marketing departments were trying to work that type of FOMO, new or first appearance, or new character. It was getting to be a little silly. So yeah, definitely by the mid to late 80s, I was getting worn out by the whole speculator bubble craze, as well as like first issue, and then Marvel was trying to work anything that made them unique, like with mutants. And that's why I really don't think like Namor is not a mutant. Same thing with like Franklin Richards. I mean, he might have been born with powers, but think about it. His parents are the Fantastic Four. They were exposed to these cosmic rays out in space. It's not a mutant. They weren't just born. And then when they hit puberty, you know, she didn't become invisible. He didn't become all, like, stretchy. So they're not mutants, dog. Like, it's that whole, like, thing with mutants is just Marvel trying to work something that makes them unique, to get rid of other forms of competition, and then to work their licensing. So, on their whole brand identity, what makes Marvel unique, right? One of it is the whole being a mutant. Another one is the whole uber angst, poor me, self-pity route with heroes that was kind of cool, I guess, when they did it with, like, Peter Parker and, you know, Bruce Banner, and then with Ben Grimm, and people having problems and trying to overcome them, and then achieve, you know, becoming a hero by dealing with them and overcoming them. But they just kept doing that whole poor me angst route too much, too repetitive. That was another cliche trope that got worked too much by the late 80s, definitely by the mid 80s. So this stuff that's going on right here, you know, this is early 80s. This is John Byrne taking over Fantastic Four after he finished the X-Men. And this is still classic Marvel. I think the 80s doesn't get as much love as it deserves.
Leadership is needed. I move for a vote of no confidence in Chancellor Valorum's leadership.
So, just want to give a shout out to 666. If you check out that channel, TRIPLE, and then the number 6. And he's just got this really great points that he makes on just the Darkhold and just how certain storylines that you might not find to be too significant long term, he can apply some long term significance to them, like with this Fantastic Four issue 277. So, I suggest y'all check it out. Doctor Strange ends up flying to Connecticut to stop Mephisto from trying to kill Reed and Sue. So the Canadian price variant, by the way, does not have the Comics Code Authority seal there. And I remember, what did I pay for this? $4. This is good condition. No, it's not. Fuck me. It's a little bit of a water staining going on right there. Son of a bitch. I gotta open up every comic. Damn. I mean, I know it was $4, but still. Like, to have to, like, I mean, that looks good. The front looks good. Not a lot of wear on the spine. And then I take it out of the bag. I got me some water damage right there. You can see the stain going on, the outline of the stain. I don't want this comic. I don't want it. I don't fucking want it. I didn't think I needed to open up every single bag. You know, like, I believe in doing some due diligence, but I didn't think I needed to open up every single bag. Every single one before I left. Yeah. Ben finds out that Johnny's hooking up with Alicia. Here's Mephisto torturing Sue and Reed. Doctor Strange freeing Franklin. Frozen in that crystal. Nice tattoo worthy image of Mephisto there. Check that out. Choose your own adventure. Looks like Ming the Merciless takeoff right there. Alright. Dire Wraith. Franklin unleashing his power on Mephisto. He's like, you're gone too. So here's another story with the Fantastic Four unconscious, kind of like that later story that John Byrne writes in issue 291, 292. Okay, so Mephisto gets, eradicated? He's like, you're gone too. So, 666, man, I guess you're speculating that when Franklin Richards got rid of Mephisto, it created these shards that Scarlet Witch used to create her kids. I don't know. I haven't connected those dots. That's why I'm throwing this out there, just kind of winging it. It's for fun, not trying to figure out what could have happened. Whoa. So yeah, just trying to get an idea of what could have happened, I suppose. When Franklin Richards used his power against Mephisto, is that what created the shards that the Scarlet Witch used to create her kids? You think? Is that your theory, 666? Interesting. Cool. So, my water damaged copy, that's two copies now. I got this one's water damaged, this one's water damaged. I mean, to have to get a stack of comics. Alright, so I got this many comics. Are you going to open up every single comic out of the bag to see if they're water damaged? Or would you kind of, I mean, even if it says $4... You know, this was $4 and it had a nice cover. It looked great. But then there's the water damage on the back. Is that worth $4? I don't think that's not worth $4 to me. That's worth a dollar, maybe two. That's a dollar book. I'd like to return it or I'd like to trade it for another $4 book. Something along those lines. I don't want this book. And same thing with... with this book too, also water damaged. So, well, we gotta spend the time driving, doing other stuff I don't want to do. I don't know. That's sometimes it happens, right? You get burned like that. Now I gotta go back to a comic book shop and see if I can trade these for some other books that aren't water damaged. This one was $6. That's not worth it. This one's $4, that's really not worth it. Let me know what y'all think. These two are water damaged. The rest of these are looking all right. And now to wrap it up. Some lessons learned here, but I mean, what's the lesson learned? You're gonna open up every single bag. You get like, what? These are 8 comics. So you're going to open up all 8 of these and then check them for water damage? I guess that's what I have to start doing. Do y'all do that? Or would you trust the shop owner? And if you had 2 that were water damaged, would you take them back? Would you call the store first and then, you know, be like, hey, I'd just like to trade these in for 2 other comics? Or get my money back? Is that asking too much of me? Let me know what you think. And Vision Comics 90s was closing. I thought they opened up till 8. They weren't. So I got this third part. This is the November/January 2018 issue of Image Plus. This issue and then the 2 preceding issues. It's a 3-part story on the inside cover that Ed Piskor does on his initial experiences finding out about Image Comics and his take on Image.
how it introduced him to new artists, writers, creators. Three issues, three pages, basically, three inside covers. And I got two copies of the first two parts, so this third final part, just wanted a second copy of, because I'm a completist like that, and it makes it easier to sell them as a set. And that's my comic book shop haul crawl for y'all. Thank you very much for watching. I be that sequential geek. Much love. Stay safe. Peace.
A strong chancellor, one who will not let our tragedy continue.